court is now in session. May the defendants take their seats. Teachers of secondary education, Mr. Mathematician, Mrs. Physicist, and Mrs. Philologist. District Attorney, please state the case.
You are accused of defrauding your students by using the term infinity in your lessons without sufficient explanation of the concept. Probably because you yourselves do not sufficiently perceive it.
Objection, Your Honor! The District Attorney is misleading the jury from the very beginning of the procedure. I assure you, Your Honor, that we are deeply aware of the meaning of the term infinity, and yes, we do use it every day with high consciousness.
Answer us, defendant. What is infinity?
But it's not that simple. I need some time. In some time, I would say it's something endless.
Your answer is not it's not satisfying enough. As long as I lived, the only thing I knew was what infinity was not.
And to me, infinity never had a clear meaning. But your answer is unclear. For instance, a circle. It doesn't have a start point nor an end point. However, you can say that it is infinite. It has specific length and decade.
You're right.
May we proceed with the first witness. Student of the first grade of high school. After 9 years of school, can you tell us what infinity is?
It's an enormous number.
There, you heard the answer. It's a number. But how can infinity even be a number?
Of course it is a real number. It has a symbol, a random name. They have positive and negative prices. For example, number 2 has plus 2 and minus 2. Or number plus 6.13 and minus 6.13. I don't understand. Why are you looking at me with such surprise?
You see, Mr. Mathematician, the results of your tutoring. A number!
Tell us, my child, according to what you said, infinity plus would be a real positive number. Do you agree?
Of course.
Assume that to plus 2, which you mentioned before, we add 6.13. What emerges?
The number plus 8.13.
Right. Which is greater both than plus 2 and 6.13, right?
But of course, the sum of two positive real numbers is always greater than its addend.
Indeed. Now if to this number plus infinity, we add plus 2. What would be the result of this addition?
I think infinity.
And if we add 6.13?
But again infinity will not be, because...
Of course! Even if we add 1 million to infinity, infinity again will get. What kind of real number is one that is bigger than himself?
Eventually, maybe not a number.
Thank you, witness. You're free to go. Now the concept begins to clarify. But let's go a little deeper into the exact meaning of infinity in mathematics.
Objection, Your Honor. Infinity is one of the most important and also most mysterious concepts in philosophy as well. Anaximander of Miletus suggests infinity as a primary element of every being and words it unlimited, eternal, and undefinable. Not to mention that some philosophers and theologists correlate infinity with God and make it unapproachable and forbidden.
Objection overruled. This is exactly the reason you're in this court. Because you confuse your students by using infinity with a totally different meaning. And you refuse to even admit it.
Okay, that happens too. But, Your Honor, some philosophers use infinity with its mathematical meaning. Zenon from Elea, father of dialectics, from Parmenides' philosophical school, suggested some paradoxes that confused his rivals and made ancient Greeks fear infinity.
Yes, yes! Zenon paradoxes are well known. Aristotle, for instance, describes the paradox of dichotomy, where something that moves from a position A to a position B will never reach its target, since it will initially have to pass through the half of segment AB, and before that, the half of the half of AB, and so on.
With full respect, Your Honor, I probably understood it. I will have to pass through all the possible middles, but are, of course, infinite.
Who gave you permission to speak and interfere with the work of justice? You should know this may raise sanctions against you.
I deeply regret my conduct, Your Honor.
Who are you?
I am the next witness, second year student of high school.
I will ignore your disrespect due to your young age. But let us proceed. Judge Archimedes, yes. What are the paradoxes Zenon suggests?
Zenon believes that it's impossible for someone to pass through infinite points, infinite time. Therefore, the movement is impossible.
Objection, Your Honor. Movement, time, their phenomena and concepts from the area of physics. You should have allowed me to speak.
It would be interesting to hear your opinion. Please approach.
As you certainly noticed, I reached the bands in 2 seconds, a really finite time. I passed all the infinite points, which consist of the distance between the defendant's table and the judge's bands, in a very short and totally finite time. So, which paradox was Ina referring to?
This movement is impossible, because there are infinite subdivisions of time and place.
Oh, with all respect, Your Honor, I'm totally confused. I understand the argument, Miss Physicist, but infinitely many hundreds must have an infinite sum.
But the sum of infinite terms can be finite.
Look, my child, what do I have here?
A square cardboard and scissors, but are we going to do a paper craft?
Not exactly. If I cut this square right in the middle, I will get 2 halves of it. Do you agree?
Yes, I agree.
I can do the same with 1 of the 2 halves. In this way, I will get 2 quarters.
I've started figuring out what you mean. You can do the same with 1 of the 2 quarters.
Exactly! And keep going with 1 of the 2 eighths, 1 of the 2 sixteenths, and so on. Truly, does this ever end?
Practically, yes. Vertically though, I will always be able to cut a piece in half, no matter how small it might be.
Very well. No matter how many those pieces are, if I put them all together, can they result something bigger than the original square?
Of course not.
So you've just admitted that the sum of infinite addends is equal to something absolutely finite.
Impressive.
You see, infinity is not a laying down net, as a previous student said. Infinity has motion, it has dynamic, it has repetition.
Could we possibly imagine infinity as a ghost approaching? Just like a mom approaches slowly his other half to kiss her, but he won't dare to do it.
You describe this perfectly. That is an image of infinity. As I have said in the past, infinity is just une façon de parler, of which one only speaks with limits.
Very well, witness. You may go. May the third witness come forward, third grade student of high school. Tell us, what do you perceive as infinite?
Hey, that symbol. It's a noun,
With your permission, Your Honor, it's an adjective. Therefore, it defines something.
That is correct, defendant. And what it defines is a number of parts forming a set of objects.
And how can we calculate this number?
Suppose you look into a theater and see that no one is standing, and also that each seat corresponds to one and only one person. Can you compare the number of seats to the number of people?
Of course. I don't even have to count the seats of the people to be sure that the number of the seats is equal to the number of the people.
Exactly. Because the whole of the spectators is in a one-to-one correspondence with the whole of the seats.
In addition to sets of objects, I can also propose sets of numbers.
This is well known.
Go on, please.
It's zero, or any other positive integer.
Good. In the first grade, you were trying to learn how to count using your fingers. For example, the set of your fingers and your right hand was into one-to-one correspondence with a set of positive integers from 1 to 5.
With your permission, Your Honor, maybe this conversation, even though very interesting, it's off its actual goal. The witness was trying to give a definition of infinity, and here we are talking about cardinality sets.
Believe me, defendant, there is nothing more relative than this, because infinite, as an adjective, defines cardinality sets.
Infinity, defining the cardinality sets, shows some bizarre properties that make it differ than numbers.
Something like the paradox that we discussed earlier.
Kind of, but there is a huge difference. In fact, it's not a paradox because there is no false syllogism. It's just different.
And they show us exactly how different a cardinality is from a number.
An example would be useful because, with all due respect, Your Honors, you talk more abstractly and more vaguely than I do in class.
Fine, fine, Mr. Mathematician. Let's assume that you were a hotel owner.
I don't think, Mr. District Attorney, that you mean I'm completely unable as a teacher, and that would be useful to change profession.
Anything but that. The fact that you're here as a defendant shows that you're really trying to be a good teacher.
Let's hope you're right, Mr. District Attorney.
So, let's assume that you have a regular hotel with 100 customers. Let's also presume that all the rooms are occupied and in each room there is only one occupant. Another customer arrives and asks for a room to spend the night, but neither of the 100 occupants want to share the room with him, but neither does he.
Oh, then it's impossible to serve the customer. I can't put 101 people in 100 rooms. It's obvious.
Think though, defendant. What if your hotel had infinite rooms? One for each positive integer.
But then, there will be a first, but not a last room.
Very well. Infinite room with one customer in each room.
Now though, the customer can be served. if each customer moves to the next room to the right. Then the room one will be free for the new customer.
But then, by the same token, this hotel could accommodate two or three new customers.
That's exactly the paradox of infinity. It has infinite elements, but without changing, it can constantly take more.
Supposing that infinite customers arrived, would you be able to serve them?
My answer is yes, because every resident will move to the room whose number is two times the original room number. That's it!
Very well, defendant. I think you showed us that you understand pretty well the meaning of infinity.
With only one move, all the residents are moved to infinite rooms. With a flick, infinite properties. We will...
It was a dream. It was all a dream. A beautiful dream. Now, I have a lot to say to the kids about infinity today. Of course, I won't be able to mention everything, but what I've seen is enough. The rest in another lesson.